Major League Baseball analyst on ESPN's Baseball Tonight, Tim Kurkjian, hardly needs any introduction. But this is a special treat for me, as we have known each other since our days trading trivia questions and sports knowledge in Bel Air Hall at the University of Maryland. That being said, I guess I could have introduced John Feinstein later today, but he's a Dukie. Go Terps. Locally, this means a lot, not only for Gaithersburg, but for Montgomery County in general. After Tim graduated from Walter Johnson High School and entered the University of Maryland Journalism Department, he started writing for the Montgomery County Journal, and then had stints with the Washington Star, Baltimore News American, Dallas Morning News, Baltimore Sun, then on to Sports Illustrated. Now he's a contributor to ESPN the magazine and ESPN.com. You can also hear him frequently on ESPN radio and TV with the likes of Mike and Mike, Tony Kornheiser, and Scott Van Pelt. I introduce to you Tim Kurkjian.
Thanks for coming. Robert, I've got my weed whacker in the car, and it's not working properly, so I'm going to bring it over during the show, okay? Maybe you can help me with that. Right now, I'm on television right now from home. On ESPN. I taped a bunch of things at my house this morning. This is how it works in my life. I taped a bunch of things, and then, like, while I'm speaking today, I'm on ESPN all over the country. This is amazing. I have a little camera in the house. It's about this big, and it's in my office, and right next to my office is my mom's room. I love my mom, but she's 92, and she's got Alzheimer's, and she wanders around once in a while, so one of these days, she's going to wander in the middle of a live shot. She does know what this means because I've had to do that several times. And one day, she's just going to come in and say, Tim, what do you want for lunch? And it's going to be the greatest live shot ever. That's my mom. So this is my new book. And I point it out to you because it's very similar in a way to my old book, except for all the stories in it are new. And I tell you that because my last book was also a Valentine for baseball fans. It was easy to read, no heavy lifting here, no real serious stuff, just something, hopefully, to make you smile and make you laugh. So when my last book came out, my nephew, Brett Townsend, had to do a report in the fifth grade on two pieces of literature that he had read. So he, as an 11-year-old, he chose Is This a Great Game or What?, which is just this mindless baseball story book that I wrote. He compared that to The Odyssey by Homer, which, of course, was written at the time of the Trojan horse. So my cousin Julie had to tell him, Brett, look, I know both of these have something to do with Homer's, which I thought was really good, but I think we should find something more comparable than Uncle Tim's book and The Odyssey. So this is similar, though, to my last book. If you like that one, hopefully you'll like this one. Again, this book is designed for baseball fans. And if you don't like baseball, hopefully you'll read this book and you'll like it after that. If you really love baseball, hopefully you'll love it even more after reading this book. Chapter one is why I believe baseball is the best game. And there are hundreds of examples in there. But one is, I finished the first chapter with a Pete Rose story. Pete Rose always has an amazing story to tell. So Pete Rose goes to jail for 4 months. He gets out of jail. He's been in jail for 4 months. He's 51 years old. He comes out. His son picks him up at the airport. And the first thing Pete says to his son is there a batting cage around here? And Pete Jr. goes, yeah, there's one right down the street. So they go to the batting cage. Pete Sr. goes to the proprietor and says, what's the fastest machine you have here? And the proprietor goes, over there, 85 miles an hour. If you haven't seen 85, that's bringing it. Trust me. So Pete Rose gets in the cage. And by now, the place is packed because Pete Rose is in the batting cage. So He swings at the first pitch. Again, 4 months in prison, 51 years old. And the first pitch he swings at, he hits a line drive right back at the pitching machine. It's unbelievable. He looks at the crowd. He throws his bat to the ground. And he says, "Some things never freaking change." And he walks away. And that's who Pete Rose is. And that, in a lot of ways, kind of symbolizes what baseball is. It's a really hard game to play, but those who play it the most skillfully are unbelievably great. And I could give you a million examples about that. And I believe it's the hardest game in the world to play. And most people disagree with me, but anyone who's played baseball understands the degree of difficulty of it. So Jeff Conine used to play for the Orioles, greatest Miami Marlin of all time. He told me once that a buddy of his, who's not even a baseball player, didn't even play in high school, said, "I want to catch Rob Nen." And at the time, Rob Nen was one of the best closers in baseball. He throws 100 miles an hour with a slider that just like flies through the strike zone. It's impossible to catch Rob Nen. But this guy goes, "I want to catch Rob Nen today." So Conine goes, "You can't catch him. He would kill you." So the guy goes, "No, I think I can do it." So they go to the picnic that day, and Conine says, "Look, if you can catch me throwing to you, then maybe we'll get some gear on you and you can take a shot at catching Rob Nen." So Conine tells me the first pitch he throws to this guy is maybe 70 miles an hour. And Conine said, "I broke his watch. First pitch, I broke his watch. And if I hadn't broken his watch, I would have broken his wrist." And finally, the guy looks at Jeff Conine and goes, "Well, maybe I can't catch Rob Nen." Really? We weren't sure about that. So it's the hardest game. It's the best game. It's filled with so many different moving pieces. I did a story a few years ago on superstitions, and I really wasn't even that excited about it because I hadn't done this story in a long time, and I didn't think people were superstitious anymore, players, and I found out every single one of them is wildly superstitious. I went to Drew Storen, formerly of the Nationals, and he said, "No, I'm not superstitious about anything. I really am not." So I pressed him on it, and then I pressed him again, and he goes, "Well, I did eat a grilled cheese sandwich and a glass of milk before every game for a year and a half. Is that qualify?" "Yes, that qualifies." And he said, "And I've worn the same underwear for every game for the last 5 years. Does that count?" "Yes, that counts." There was a little middle infielder named Elliot Johnson who told me that when he's in the field, he has to chew grape bubblegum. Has to. But when he's at the plate, he has to chew watermelon bubblegum. Those are the rules. So he gets traded in midseason. He goes to the Braves, and the first thing he does is check the clubhouse and ask the kids there, "Do you guys have watermelon bubblegum?" And they said, "No." And he goes, "Well, you got to get me some. The hits are in the watermelon bubblegum." So the kids rush out to the store. They bring back watermelon bubblegum. He gets it just in time. And he gets a hit that night, and he looks at me, and this is a smart guy, Elliot Johnson, and he says, "I got a hit because I was chewing watermelon bubblegum, because that's how it works." And it's ridiculous. But with the degree of difficulty of the game, this is necessary to these guys. Whatever it's going to take to get a hit off of Steven Strasburg tonight, they're going to try it. By the way, Steven Strasburg, do we all know how good he is? I mean, really. And now he's back for the Nationals, which is good. A couple years ago, I had lunch with John Kruk and Mike Schmidt, who doesn't belong at that table, by the way. And during lunch, Mike Schmidt looks at me and says, "How does anyone ever get a hit off of Steven Strasburg?" This is Mike Schmidt. He's the greatest third baseman ever. That's how he viewed a pitcher of today. That's how good Steven Strasburg is. And that's why he's a National for 7 more years, and there's no way around it. That is really good news for the Nationals. As for John Kruk, by the way, I've worked with him for years, and he's exactly like he appears to be on television. He's a big, fat, lovable guy, and he says the oddest things. Like, I was on a bus with him, the bus tour with ESPN years ago, and this is typical Kruk. He just looks at me out of the blue and says, "Did I ever tell you about the time I shot a deer in the hot tub?" And with Kruk, you have to ask, "John, were you in the hot tub? Was the deer in the hot tub? Or were both of you in the hot tub? You never know with Kroc. So he explains, yeah, I'm 18 years old. I live in West Virginia. I'm a redneck. I've got my shotgun right next to the hot tub. And then he looks at me like, yeah, that's where I keep my shotgun, right next to the hot tub. So he gets up, butt naked, shoots a deer, sits back down in the hot tub. That's who John Kroc is. He's got a million stories like that. We were doing another trip where we were going to see, this is a little graphic, sorry, we were going to see Edwin Rodriguez, who is the manager of the Marlins. So I said to John, I said, Crucky, do you know Edwin Rodriguez? And he said, yeah, I picked up his teeth one day. And I went, what? And he goes, we were playing winter ball, and Edwin was at the plate, and the pitch hit him right in the mouth, and his teeth went flying all over the place. So Kroc picked up two of his teeth and handed it to him and said, these are yours. So the first base coach, Jose De Leon, comes down to make sure Edwin's okay. And it's so hideous that Jose De Leon faints right there. And they bring the ambulance. And Edwin Rodriguez tells me, they took De Leon away and they didn't take me. These are the things that happen in baseball. They happen all the time. And when I hear a good story, I never forget it. And when I hear it, I have to write it down and I have to put it somewhere. And that's what's in this book. These are my favorite stories from mostly the last 10 years, but really the 37 years I've covered baseball, much like my last book. Like, for instance, baseball player gloves have always fascinated me, their attachment, their love affair with their gloves. Like Rene Gonzalez, who used to play for the Orioles, used to carry his glove around in a Wonder Bread bag. And I said, what is that? And he goes, well, the slogan is no holes, so that's where I'm going to keep my glove. So he would carry his baseball glove around in a bread bag. What a dope. But it worked for him. Darwin Barney, who's still playing in the big leagues, he carries the exact five model gloves with him wherever he goes, and he breaks them in systematically, one day at a time. He's breaking them in perfectly. He never uses his game glove except for in the game, meaning the 2 minutes before the game when he's playing catch to get ready to go out on the field, he never uses his game glove. His game glove is only used for the game, and it stays his game glove until he can't use it anymore. He made an error in Washington here a few years ago. He's a great defender, and the minute he made the error, he got rid of the glove. I said, you put it in your bag. He said, no, I threw it in the trash can. It wasn't any good anymore. I made an error. And he got rid of it. And then the other four gloves moved up, and now he's got a new gamer. This is how it works with these guys. Mike Gallego played for the A's and a bunch of other teams, Yankees, for years. He's a dinky little guy. He's like an inch taller than me. But he's got great hands and really big hands. By the way, I got really big hands. I don't know if you noticed. And seriously, my hands, they don't do me any good, by the way, being this good, this big. But my hands are twice as big as Tony Gwynn's hands. Tony Gwynn's one of the greatest hitters ever, and my hands dwarf his hands. Dustin Pedroia's hands, half the size of my hands. And he's the MVP of the league and still one of the best players in the game, and I type for a living, which doesn't make any sense. So Mike Gallego, his glove is the most important thing to him. So during the 89 World Series, there's an earthquake. I was there. It was the most terrifying thing I've ever been through in my life. So the Candlestick Park, where we're going to play a World Series game, has now basically shut down. It's dark. Everyone is told, get out on the field. It might be the only safe place in the ballpark. So Mike Gallego is rushed out with everyone else, and then he realizes, oh my gosh, my glove. It's in the clubhouse. It's not safe. So he found his way back into the clubhouse, which is pitch black. And the security guys go, you can't go in there. It might collapse. You're not allowed back in there. And he goes, I'm going back in there. And he goes in and he rescues his glove. And he brings it out and he goes, this is my baby. I can't let this alone. That's how they think about this. And Nick Punto played years as a utility infielder, and I saw him one day before a game playing catch. He's got this really old glove, and it looked like it had moisture, like liquid or something all over. It had a shine to it, and I say, what have you got on your glove? And he said, well, this morning I sprayed it with Aquanet, which we put on, well, women put on their hair. And he said, then I put some suntan lotion on it. So he puts all this stuff on his glove to keep it nice and firm, but also keep it lubricated. And that's what he does. And he said, this is really graphic. Don't take this home with you. But he said, I was in the bathroom this morning, and I saw some Glade. So I just picked up some Glade and sprayed my glove with it and came out on the field. That's what guys do with their gloves. And this is how the game operates. Whatever it takes to make them better today, that's what they'll do. There's also a chapter in this book on the sounds of the game. And Adam Dunn, by the way, was who I miss terribly every single day, talked constantly during every game. He talked to everyone who reached first base. He talked to every umpire. He talked to every catcher. And you couldn't stop him from talking. Adam LaRoche told me that if there's nobody around Adam Dunn, he will just talk to himself for the entire game. That's how he is. But one thing that struck me there was Lance Berkman, really good hitter for a really long time. He used to get in the box and carry on a conversation with the catcher while the at-bat is going on. So I'm going to leave this for a second. So he's right here, and he's getting ready for the at-bat, and he looks at the catcher and goes, you know, my dog, we just got a new dog. This dog is killing me. He is tearing up everything in the house. And then he gets ready, and the pitch comes in, and then he goes, he tore up the sheets yesterday. And this entire conversation goes along while he's in the batter's box during a major league at-bat. This is what goes on during the course of a game that people just have no idea about. And when I learn something like that, I can't wait to get to my computer and write it and put it somewhere. And again, that's what I have in my book. So the best part about settings like this for me are the questions that people have for me, okay? Your questions always bring the best answers. So I want you to ask me anything that you like about baseball, about ESPN, about that book, about living in this area, whatever you like. Just raise your hand. I'll get to as many questions as I can because I promise you this will be the best part. Yes.
So what is your take on the brawl that took place on Sunday between the Rangers and the Blue Jays?
So we had a big brawl on Sunday, and Rougned Odor punched Jose Bautista right in the mouth. I don't think I've ever seen a punch quite like that in a major league game, and I've seen this forever. And there's a whole book, there's a whole chapter in this book about unwritten rules, like when you're allowed to flip your bat, and when you're allowed to throw at a guy, and when you're allowed to punch a guy. And what I learned from the unwritten rules is they're very interpretive, and nobody necessarily agrees on what the unwritten rules are. Everyone looks at them a little differently. So my thinking was that 7 months after Jose Bautista hit the second biggest home run in the history of the Toronto Blue Jays, he got hit in the ribs by a pitcher who, by the way, just got out of prison himself, which I find ironic on a lot of different levels. But it speaks to the long memory and the remorseless, vengeful players that play in the big leagues. In this book, I tell the story about Ed Farmer, who gave up a home run to Wayne Gross a long time ago. And Wayne Gross is a borderline player, and Ed Farmer's a reliever, so he doesn't get to face Wayne Gross again. And he's furious because it's been 3 years, and he still hasn't gotten him back for taking his sweet time running around the bases. So the next time he faces Wayne Gross is in spring training, batting practice, and their teammates. So the first pitch Ed Farmer throws to Wayne Gross, he hits him right in the back. And Wayne Gross screams at him, "What was that for?" And he goes, "That was for 3 years ago." And that's how it works. Mike Flanagan, the great Mike Flanagan, I wrote his obituary in this book. He made me cry. It was so bad. He told me about the day that Al Bumbry scored a run in a major league game, and when he crossed home plate, he made it look like he didn't see Dennis Eckersley, who was backing up the plate, the pitcher who was backing up, and he ran him over like a football player runs him. Oh, sorry, I didn't see you there. So Flanagan says to Bunbury afterwards, "Al, what was that all about? You ran him over." And Bunbury goes, "He hit me with a pitch in 1984. And Flanagan goes, "B, that was 8 years ago." And he said, "I don't care, it hurt." And he had to get him back. This is how it operates. In fact, Stan Williams, former major league pitcher, he used to carry a bunch of names in his hat. And somebody asked him, like, "What's that list of names?" And he goes, "Well, those are the guys I got to get." And someone said, "Well, why do you keep them in your hat?" And he said, "So I never forget them." And I just heard the other day, it's not in this book, but it'll be in the next one, Stan Williams hit a batter in an old-timers game because he couldn't get him during the regular season when he was a real player. That's the vengeful nature of baseball players.
If you're advising Mike Rizzo on what could put the Nats over the top in the NL East and maybe give them a realistic shot at beating the Cubs in the playoffs, what would you suggest he do? What move?
The question is, how would I advise Mike Rizzo to get the Nationals into the playoffs and beat the Cubs? The Nationals are going to the playoffs. They're really good. The Cubs are better than they are right now, but they're really good. I would advise him, and this is what we do in the media, by the way. We tell general managers what to do. Great idea. You do this professionally. I'm a sports writer, and I tell you how to do your job. Wow. I would tell him to get another hitter, one way or another, because between us, and this is not between us, but I'm not sure Jason Worth is a middle-of-the-order hitter for a championship-caliber team now, and I'm not sure Ryan Zimmerman is either. They're both major leaguers. They belong in the lineup. They need one more hitter to go behind Bryce Harper, who, by the way, walked 13 times in a four-game series. Nobody's ever walked 13 times in a series in Major League history, ever. He had 7 plate appearances with 0 official at-bats. That's never happened either. So they need some help for Harper. And I would also advise Mike Rizzo, who's not going to listen to me, by the way, to get Lucas Giolito to the big leagues whenever he's ready. Because trust me when I tell you this, that kid's going to be great. And when you can throw Max Scherzer, Steven Strasburg, and Lucas Giolito 1-2-3 in any series, that is the textbook definition of a nightmare for opposing hitters. Because those guys all throw close to 100 with balls that just fly out of the strike zone and in the strike zone. He's going to be really good. And by the way, Lucas Giolito, here's what we can do now in baseball. We count how many spins a curveball, how many times a curveball spins. We have the spin rate of curveballs for every player in the major leagues. So we know whose curveball spins the most. The one that spins the most is, in theory, going to be the best one. Fortunately, Don Mattingly, Miami Marlins manager, said, "Look, fellas, I don't need to know what the spin rate is to know that nobody can hit that curveball." And there's a lesson here, by the way. We have over-staticized this game, and nobody loves the stats more than me, but we have over-staticized the game to the point where I'm a little bit worried about it now. I covered the Little League World Series last year, and I interviewed a 12-year-old kid who's the greatest 12-year-old hitter I have ever seen. He's unbelievably good. But I asked him, "Cole, when you are not using an aluminum bat, are you using a wooden bat to get you ready?" And he goes, "Yeah, I use a wooden bat every day." And I said, "Can you tell the difference between a wood bat and an aluminum bat?" And a 12-year-old kid looks at me and goes, "Yes, my exit velocity with an aluminum bat is 92.1 miles an hour. With a wooden bat, it's 83.4 miles an hour." And I'm a little worried about that a 12-year-old knows the exit velocity off of his bat. I think we should just be a little bit more concerned with actually playing the game, like running the bases and learning how to play first base and doing all the things in the game rather than knowing the spin rate on a curveball and the exit velocity off of an aluminum bat. So that kind of stuff worries me a little bit.
The Nationals are vindicated in how they handled prosper, especially with everything that's going on with Matt Harvey right now?
Yeah, the question is, are the Nationals vindicated? I had no problem with what they did from the beginning because Davey Johnson told me on February the 1st, here's what we're going to do this year. We're going to shut him down when we get to whatever it was, 175 innings. That's it. They never wavered. They told us this is the best thing for him. And as it turns out, they were right. And I'm amazed how many people are still think the Nationals are trying to reinvent the wheel here. We know more than you guys do and everything else. They're angry that the Nationals shut down their best pitcher when it has no business of theirs. The Nationals were saying, this is a great prospect. We need to keep him healthy. And yet people questioned all the way through what they were doing. And now Matt Harvey has an ERA about 6. He's struggling terribly. And maybe it's because he pitched too many innings. I don't know. But they just chose not to protect him like the Nationals did. In the end, I think the Nationals did the right thing protecting Steven Strasburg.
What's your take on it?
Yes, the question is instant replay, and I'm not a real big fan of it, I must tell you. I think it slows the game down. And George Will, if I may drop a name, once told me that in Washington there's a theory that when you try to perfect something, you don't even make it better. And that could be the case here. By the way, George Will wrote the foreword for my book. George Will. Do you know how much smarter he is than me? Do you know that I go to lunch with him and Charles Krauthammer 2 or 3 times a year? And it's like the 2 smartest guys in the world. I feel like Fred Flintstone sitting next to them. And I do all the talking because these guys love baseball so much. They can't wait to get away from President Obama and gay marriage and all these really difficult things. They just want to go have lunch and talk to a guy who will tell them a bunch of baseball stories. That's what I do. Whatever. George wrote the foreword, and his point is that when we try to make this replay system perfect, I don't even think it's better. Now, look, I'm all for getting some calls right, but it seems the process seems to be regressing a little bit. It's taking more time now to get this right, and then I'm not even sure they're getting it right. And yes, I've been to the New York facility. It's great. It's like you're an air traffic controller there. You're watching 15 games at once. What concerns me a little bit is the umpires are running that facility, and they're judging other umpires. And sometimes I worry that they're going to say, all right, we're going to side with the guys on the field here so we don't make them look bad. There's a little bit of a worry there. I hope this goes in the right direction, but it still needs to be perfected because it's far from perfect now.
Tim, what's your thought on to this other gentleman's question about pitchers and their arms? Back in the day, many pitchers pitched 200 innings a season. Today, hardly anyone does. Is it because they throw so fast?
Right. The question is, why doesn't anybody complete a game anymore? It's a really good question, Peter. Our own Max Scherzer here holds the major league record for consecutive starts at the beginning of a career without throwing a complete game. He went 163 starts without a complete game. Think about that. Jake Peavy won a Cy Young without completing a game in a season. And it wasn't that long ago that Jim Palmer completed 27 games in one season, not to mention Warren Spahn, who completed way more than that. The bottom line is this. We get kids to the minor leagues, and we protect them to the point where they never pitch more than 5 innings, they never pitch more than 100, throw more than 100 pitches, and then we get them out of there to protect them. And yet, it's a paradox. The more we protect them, the more they get injured. And I'm not sure what's going on. I think the best thing I've heard is from Tom House, who's a former major league pitcher and pitching coach and knows more about the throwing of a baseball than anyone I've ever met. And he told me, this problem with pitchers' arms starts when the kids are 10 years old. And he said, our kids today are pitching too much and they're not throwing enough. His thinking is this. When we were 10 years old, we threw a baseball, a tennis ball, a football, a bunch of rocks. We were throwing all sorts of things from all different arm angles, and that's how we strengthened our arms. Now our 10-year-olds are standing on a mound. They're throwing this motion every time, 12 months out of the year. That's where our kids are getting hurt. So when they get to the big leagues, they're already hurt. It's just a matter of time before they have to fix that. So I'm with Tom House when I say, please, kids, put the ball down for 3 months out of the season and go make the basketball team. It will make you a better baseball player. I promise. The common denominator of every great baseball player I've ever met is he was a multi-sport star in high school. Being a soccer player makes you a better baseball player and vice versa. We loved it when the football quarterback joined our basketball team because he was competitive, he was in shape, and he wanted to play another sport. Our kids today are throwing too much. They're pitching too much, and we have to get them off the mound. We have to get them off the field a couple of months a year and just take a break. That's my concern. The question is, how has Barry Bonds changed since he was a player? He was really fun to deal with as a player. Here's how bad he was with some of it, with people. Not just the media. He hated the media. I understood that. He just hated me because I was a little sports writer. So that's why he didn't like me. He didn't like all of us. But I had teammates tell me that Barry Bonds would tell him like a really funny joke one day, and then he wouldn't even talk to some of his teammates for 30 days in a row. They'd go talk to him, and he would just walk right by him. They're his own teammates. So he was a difficult guy to deal with. And I think he's changed a little bit because being a hitting coach requires a bedside manner, which is really difficult to figure out. You got to go soothe these guys, comfort these guys, cajole these guys, and get them ready to play that day. And I'm told Barry is doing better at that. And he actually smiled at me the other day without throwing something at me, so that was really good. But he can be difficult to deal with because that job is really tough to do. Eddie Murray, of course, was a similar way. Eddie Murray didn't talk to me for like 4 years. I'm not proud of this. It's just the way it works. But Aaron Boone, who's one of my favorite guys at ESPN, he had Eddie Murray as his hitting coach. And he went to the batting cage for early hitting on June the 4th. He's hitting 150 on June the 4th. And Eddie Murray, the hitting coach for the Indians, sees Aaron Boone coming. And he goes like this. Oh, God. And just shakes his head like, oh my gosh, he's back. Well, you can't look at your own teammate that way. You have to help him. And that's where Barry Bonds, we'll see how he does. But I can tell you this, he knows a lot about hitting. He can teach it, he understands it, and he's really, and you know, we're not allowed to tell people how great Barry Bonds was, but I can tell you, if you can forget the other stuff for a moment, he's the greatest hitter I've ever seen. And after Babe Ruth and Ted Williams, the third greatest hitter ever is Barry Bonds. There's no way around that statistically. The rest of it causes a lot of trouble for all of us, especially me as a Hall of Fame voter. Don't start me on that. Yes. I'm amazed we got like 20 questions in before we got a Pete Rose question. Usually it's in the top three. Pete Rose is one of the greatest players I've ever seen. His timing on the field was impeccable. His timing since he's retired has been unbelievably bad. And I still kind of like him, but he can be rude and crude and really say and do the wrong thing at the wrong time. And that's one reason that he's not in the Hall of Fame. If he had come out that day that he was suspended by Bart Giamatti and told everyone, I'm an addictive gambler, I have a problem, I'm gonna get it fixed, he would have been in the Hall of Fame 10 years ago. But he's not even close to getting in now. And I don't see this commissioner, Rob Manfred, or even the next one saying, all right, we're changing the rules, we're putting Pete in the Hall of Fame, or we're putting him on the writer's ballot, or we're gonna put him on a veterans committee ballot. I think we're gonna meet here 15 years from now. And we're going to ask the same question. Do you ever think he's going to get in the Hall of Fame? I had to, on TV several years ago, answer the question, would I vote for Pete Rose if he were on the ballot? And grudgingly, I said yes, because I'm voting for him as a player. So I see Frank Robinson about a week later in spring training. I like Frank Robinson. He likes me. And he starts screaming at me. I said, what are you so mad about? He said, I can't believe you said you would vote for that guy. If that guy gets in the Hall of Fame, I will never go back to the Hall of Fame for any function ever again, because he violated the number one rule in baseball: you don't bet on the game. And I have a scout friend of mine who's about 92 now, and he told me, get this, he told me if Pete Rose had killed somebody, it would be less of a violation than what he did. I said, Mel, please. And he goes, Tim, you weren't around for the aftermath of the Black Sox scandal. I was, he said. And if we're not sure if the games are on the up and up, then this means nothing. That's how strongly people feel about the Pete Rose issue. And right now, there is no Pete Rose issue. He's not in, and he's not getting in anytime soon. And I really find that unfortunate.
Will you share a Terry Francona
memory? Terry Francona, oh my God. I traveled with him for a year on Baseball Tonight. And he is the single funniest in-uniform person that I have ever met in my life. Just to give you an example, he's in a situation like this, and he's the manager of the Red Sox, and the Japanese reporter over there, poor guy, asks a question to Terry Francona with this many people around, and the poor guy is trying to do it in English, and he's really trying hard, but it's painful for him to try to speak English. So it's finally over. Everyone is so uncomfortable. And finally, Terry looks at the guy and goes, you're from Western Pennsylvania, aren't you? Which is where Terry Francona's from. And of course, everyone starts to laugh. And he diffused another really bad situation. That's who Terry Francona is. So he came to the bus tour. And his first day on the bus tour, this may not translate, but they put him and I in a Disney property, since ESPN is owned by Disney. It was called Camp Wilderness. So I'm thinking this might not be a four-star hotel, but when we get there, it's a log cabin. And they're like, you get your individual log cabin. So you walk in, it has bunk beds in there. And it's Terry Francona calls me and says, is this really where we're staying? And I said, yeah, I guess this is it. He calls room service and says, could you deliver? And the lady said, sir, room service was the Coke machine at the front desk. That's room service at our hotel. And this is Terry Francona's first day on the job for ESPN, and he's staying in a log cabin. And he calls me about 10 minutes later, and he says, do you want to go out in the backyard and make some s'mores with me? And that's a two-time World Series champion. If I spent every day the rest of my life with Terry Francona, I would be very happy, and I would laugh a lot because he's hysterically funny.
What's your take on the
Masson TV contract?
Yeah.
The Masson TV contract. Not as funny as Terry Francona, by the way. This is a real problem, seriously, and the Nats, pardon my language, are getting screwed on this. The way you make money in today's game is with local TV radio packages. Look at what the Dodgers have. Look what the Diamondbacks just signed. Look what the Phillies have. They're awash with cash because of all these local TV packages that they have. Meanwhile, the Nationals are splitting their package with the Orioles. And I'm no businessman. I'm sure we got businessmen all over there. For the competitor to be controlling another competitor's radio TV market is a really unhealthy situation. And unfortunately for the Nationals, everything is ruled against them so far, but this is a classic case of Peter Angelo saying, look, if I'm going to let you move the Nationals 40 miles from my ballpark, you're going to pay me a fortune to begin with, and I'm controlling the broadcast rights. So my team makes most of the money. And that's where we are. And unfortunately, I don't see a big change in that anytime soon. And it's going to be important because Bryce Harper is coming up for free agency. They're going to need every dime they can get, because I don't know if you noticed, but that guy's really good.
Yeah. Mind you have a cup stand here first, so we're going to put this
last night or two nights ago, walk-off walk to a relief pitcher in the 13th inning is a quirky ending to the Cubs Brewers game. Your favorite quirky ending that you can think of to a baseball game?
Favorite quirky ending there, well, there are a million of them. Of course, the Travis Wood walk with the bases loaded was just priceless. I love stuff like that. You have no idea how excited I get about things like that. Way too much, by the way. So the Red Sox hit back-to-back walk-off homers several years ago. And I checked, and I checked with the people who can find this, because I don't have it in my database at home. So I called the Elias Sports Bureau, and I said, tell me the last time the Red Sox hit back-to-back walk-off homers, consecutive games. So the guy calls me back and says it was 1935, and a pitcher hit both of them in a doubleheader. Wes Farrell pitched the entire game. Peter, he pitched the entire game and hit a walk-off homer to end the game. And then he came up as a pinch hitter in the second game of the doubleheader and hit another walk-off homer. And I just went, oh my God, this is like the greatest thing I've ever heard. You have no idea how excited I get. What? Whatever. Bruce Bochy hit a walk-off homer once. Bruce Bochy is the Giants manager, okay? He also has the biggest head of any player that's ever played in the major leagues. It's literally like 8.5, okay? The next step is a 9, okay? It's an 8.5. So he hits a walk-off homer off Nolan Ryan, who also pitched the whole game. So Bochy is a very much a backup catcher. He doesn't hit many homers. So they celebrate it by running a red carpet from the beginning of the clubhouse all the way to Bochy's locker. And in Bochy's locker, they have a six-pack of beer with ice in his helmet. Bochy told me he had to, whenever he got traded, he would have to bring his helmet with him, spray paint it the new colors, because nobody had an 8.5 helmet. So this night, of course, it's a walk-off, six-pack of beer with ice in Bochy's helmet. Terry Kennedy, one of the catchers at the time, told me, you know, you can get a six-pack of beer in a lot of guys' helmets, but only in Bochy's helmet can you get a six-pack of beer with ice. Right. The question is, why do wins and losses for a pitcher no longer matter? That's a really good question. I'm not sure there's a good answer to it. Why don't RBIs matter anymore for hitters? Look, I'm 59 years old. When you won 20 games when I was a kid, that really meant something. And when you knocked in 100 runs, that really meant something. And now we have a new era of statistics. And I repeat, I love data. Give me more stats. Whatever it is, give it to me. I'm going to take a look at it. But this thought that we have a new wave statistician that's going to tell you that RBIs are irrelevant, sorry, I'm not buying that. And I'm not buying that wins are irrelevant because they're just a function of the team and it's all about the luck of the game. It's not. Great pitchers find a way to win. And it's a real problem in the game today that our older guys in uniform, the Buck Showalters of the world, look at things one way, and then the stat guys look at it another way. Dusty Baker, our Dusty Baker now, told me his last year with the Reds, they had a team meeting with the coaches and the front office. So there are about 20 people in the room, and they're determining where the club is going from here. So the GM starts the meeting, and he asks the sabermetric guy over in the corner to start the meeting. This guy's never played a day in his life, and he's starting the meeting. And Dusty goes, wait a minute. He's starting the meeting? That's where we start with him? As opposed to with me, who's had a uniform on for 40 years? This is where we are now, that a new wave of statisticians are taking over the game, and I'm not sure it's great. For instance, Buck Showalter told me that the stat guys came down and told him in his office Nelson Cruz can play center field. This is about 12 years ago. So Buck said, well, he can't play center field, but we're out of the race, and you guys are the bosses, so if you want to put him out there for a couple weeks, it's okay with me, but he can't play center field. So they put him out there for a week, and the GM and the stat guys come down and said, okay, you were right. He can't play center field. And then they looked at him, and I find this more than mildly insulting, and they said, Buck, how did you know? And he didn't say it, but he should have. I've worn this uniform for 40 years. I know what a great jump is. I know what first step quickness is. He doesn't have it. I can see that stuff, and you can't. And that's why we have to listen to what Buck Showalter says. We have to listen to the stat guys over there. But we have to meet somewhere in the middle, because if we only listen to Buck, that's not a great idea. As smart as he is, he's the smartest baseball guy in the world. But to only listen to the stat guys is a really big mistake, because when we take the human element out of this game, that's a really bad idea. All right, I have one more minute. This is the last question. It better be a good one. The one-game wild card, I must say, I'm in with both feet. I think it's great. I think it gives a Game 7 quality to the playoffs on the first day of the playoffs. You lose like the NCAA tournament, you're going home. And I love that about it. The intensity for those games are so unbelievably high. And is it fair that the Pirates have done this 3 years in a row and then they go home? No, it's not fair. But if it's so unfair, just go win the division. And then you don't have to do this. It adds additional integrity to the regular season, the 162-game marathon. Go win that first, and then you don't have to play in a one-game playoff. Okay, my time's up. Thank you, Robert. Thank you for introducing me. And I'll bring the weed whacker over a little bit later. Thank you.